We don't want to be clouded in our hearts. We want to be in a place where we can hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. So we don't want to be distracted.
The Bible demonstrates this in Joshua chapter 6.
We don't want to be clouded from any vain imaginations in our minds or in our hearts. We want to empty ourselves out right now. We want to empty ourselves out unto God right now. For the Bible says that we also cast our cares on Him because He cared for us. So right now we're just going to throw everything out. That situation that we don't have no control over, that situation that been got out of hand, that situation that's holding us in bondage, we want to empty it out to God today. That circumstance that have not been addressed, that circumstance that has not been taken care of, we want to just lay it at the feet of the Lord right now. That bill we worried about, that thing that has us so wrapped up in our minds and in our hearts, we want to just throw that at His feet too. Right now we emptying it out. Right now we emptying it out. We emptying it out that issue that's going on our jobs. We emptying out that issue that's going on in our homes, around our homes. We want to empty out that concern that we have hidden that we ain't told nobody about. We want to give Him that fear and that lost hope. We want to give Him all that stuff right now, because these things have a tendency of clouding our minds and keeping us from being in that place where we need to be in God, that we can welcome Him into our sanctuary. So when I say our sanctuary, I don't literally mean the church. I mean our hearts. Because the only way that He can reside in our hearts is if we make room for Him. And the only way that we can make room for Him is if we empty out some things, if we let go of some things. Anything that may prevent us from concentrating on God right now, please, please let it go. Throw it at His feet. We're not going to worry about who's looking at us. We're not going to worry about what nobody's thinking about us or what nobody's saying or how we should do this or how we should do that or all the inappropriate or appropriate acts. We're not going to worry about any of that stuff right now. We just want to cast our cares on God because we know that He cared for us. That thing that we are worried about concerning our parents. That thing we're worried about concerning even our own selves that we never, ever tell anybody. We want to give that to God too. That hidden stuff. I see a lot of hidden stuff. And as I look at these hidden things, He's actually letting me see specifically what they are. So we want to throw that at His feet too. Anything, naturally as well as spiritually, we want to just give it to Him right now. Give it all to Him right now, because we do want Him to rest in this place. We want him to rest within our hearts. We want him to reside in our temples, that secret place. That's what we really want. Because once we're in that secret place, then we'll be able to praise him. So we want to get to that place where we don't want or desire anything and anybody but God. That's the only way we can fall into that realm of praise. We want to actually become one with God. I'm not sure what nobody else's desire is, but that's my soul desire. So we want to just get to that place. We want to concentrate on him right now. We want to concentrate on him right now.
Let my ear hear as you hear. It is you I want. It is you I need. Everything I am, let it be in me. It is you I want.
Thank you, Jesus.
It is you I need. Everything.
We should be concentrating on God right now. We should not allow ourselves to be distracted or consumed by anything, anybody, any source but him. We just want to be in that place where we can lift him up. Sometimes there be so much stuff going on in our lives and our hearts and our minds that it be hard for us to even think. My God, help us. To even think on him completely and solely.
Everything I am, let it be me.
Because there be so much noise going on. And when I say so much noise, I mean so many situations, circumstances, half chances, whatever it may be.
It
be so much noise. It be so chaotic. And so we really can't even hear him soundly. Oh God, help us, Lord. Help us, God. We can't hear him over all that noise and all that stuff that's going on in the inside of us. And then we wonder why we feel the way we feel. We think the way we think. We act the way we act. Because we are not allowing ourselves to get and be consumed in just Jesus. Because of the cares of this world. So we just want to give it all to him right now. Because we finna get ready to lift him up and praise him. I'm trying to give y'all enough time to clear your minds and to clear your hearts. Because today gonna be something different. and I'm in expectation. Because what he did for me, I know he can do for everybody else. I know. So we just want to empty everything out. Every little bitty thing, every concern. If there's anything that's within you that you even believe is a small part of being a hindrance or a stumbling block, throw it out to him right now. Give it to him right now. So that we can lift him up. So that we can give him all the glory and all the honor, because he is truly worthy. There's none other like God in all the earth. He is the King of kings, and he is the Lord of lords. He is great, and he is greatly to be praised. So we just want to lift him up right now. We want to lift him up right now. Remember what he said on last Tuesday. Time is winding down. We're going to praise. We're going to thank him. We're going to worship him. And then we're going to tell him how much we love him. So while y'all doing these things, he also gave me the right and the authority to pray for the things that are necessary for us, because y'all can only do four things this week. I got you covered in everything else. Thank you, Jesus. So we want to get to that place. Oh God, we come to you on today, and we just want to lift you up, God. Oh God, we just want to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise, God, because you are worthy, Lord. There is none other like you, God, in all the earth. You are truly one of a kind, God. There's none like you now, then, and even to come. Oh God, you are he who was, who is, and is to come. Oh God, and we just want to bless you right now, Father God. We just want to lift you up on today, Father God. We don't want to hold back anything, Father God. We don't want to be modest, God. We're not going to worry about who's looking at us. We're not going to worry about what nobody else is doing, God. We're not going to worry about what nobody else is saying concerning our praise to you, Father God, because we have to have an individual praise and on right now. I want to praise your God with every morsel of my being, God. Because you are worthy of it, Father God. You are worthy of it, God. You are worthy, Father God, in the name of Jesus. You are worthy and worthy all by yourself, Father God. I know that all the praise, the glory, and the honor is yours, God. I know that it is due you, God. Oh God, and we just want to lift you up. We want to lift you up on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, because that's why you created us, God. You created us to do this thing, God, with the very fruit of our lips, God, and we dare not hold anything back, God. Oh God, we want to lift you up on today, Father God. Not just with our voices, God, not just with the voices or the words with our tongue. Oh God, but we want to lift you up in our minds, God. We want to lift you up in our hearts, God. And if it be anything, Father God, that we have exalted higher than you, oh God, we put it down right now, God. We put it down right now, God. Any crown we ever won, God, we lay at your feet, God. Any title we ever obtained, God, we lay at your feet, God. God. Anything we have accomplished, God, we lay at your feet right now, Lord. Oh God, we lay it at your feet right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we just want to be in your presence. Oh God, we just want to be in your presence right now. God, we just want to lift you up and give you the glory, the honor, and the praise, God. We magnify you on today, God. We exalt you on today, God. And if we had any vain imaginations, God, that we lifted up above you, God, we want to put it down right now, Father. Anything that we idolize in our lives, God, we want to put it down right now, Father. Oh God, we just want to cast it down right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Because nothing is higher than you, God. No one can sit on your throne but you alone, God. Oh God, and we just want to bless you, Lord. We just want to bless you right now, God. We just want to bless you right now, God, and we want to tell you thank you for what you have done. Oh God, you've done so much.
I lift you high.
Oh God, we just want to thank you today, God.
I lift you high.
We thank you on today, Father God, for the things that you do that we don't even know about. We thank you on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, for doing things, Father God, that we cannot even imagine. Oh God, we just want to thank you on today for everything that you have done, everything you're going to do, and everything that you are doing right now, God. We thank you for the wisdom and the knowledge and the understanding, the peace, the joy, and the harmony, God. We thank you for letting us walk, talk, eat, sleep, smell, taste, feel, hear, touch, God. We thank you for the use of our arms and the use of our legs, Lord. We take nothing for granted, God. We realize everything that you have given us, Lord. It is a gift and a privilege, and we come to you just to say thank you, God. We thank you on today, God, for watching over and keeping us all during the night from all hurt, harm, and danger, seen and unseen. Oh God, we come to you. We just want to thank you on today, Father God, for keeping that robber away and even that murderer, Father God, that burglar from coming in our homes, God. Oh God, we come to you. We just want to thank you on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you for giving us your traveling mercies, God, as we travel the highways and the byways, God, and encamping your angels around our cars, God, and keeping us from that accident, that rollover, even that head on, God. We come to you and we just want to thank you for your protection, God. We thank you for the covering of your angels on today, Father God. We thank you for placing your angels in here on today, Father God. Oh God, we just want to thank you on today, Father God, for even giving us the right mind on this morning, God, because we could have woke up a lunatic, God. We could have woke up not even knowing our name, not even knowing which way to go, Father God. Oh God, so we come to you on today, God, and we just want to thank you on today, God. We thank you for the clarity that you have given us, Father God, and the things that we do not even understand, and even in the midst of us not even understanding, God, we thank you for opening up the revelation, Father God. We thank you for opening up our hearts on today, God, that we may be able to receive what you have for us, God. We thank you for opening up our minds on today, Father God, that we may be able to hear and understand what you're saying to us, God. We come to you. We just want to thank you on today, Father God. We count it all a privilege. Oh God, I need to go see you. We thank you for the food on our table, the clothes on our backs, the roof of our head, and even the car that you give us to drive, God. We thank you for the jobs that you have given us, Father God, in the name of Jesus. We come to you. We just want to thank you, God.
Magnify you, Jesus.
We thank you for forgiving us for our sins, Father God. Because we have all sinned, God, and fallen short. David, there's nobody except. Oh God, we come to you. We just want to thank you on today, Father God. We thank you for giving us your son, Jesus, God, that he may come and die for our very sins, Father God. Even though we weren't even worthy of it, Father God, you allowed him to come, God, and for that, we want to say thank you, God. We want to thank you on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, for the completeness, even when we felt like we was incomplete. We want to thank you for the fixing of your people, Father God. For the change. For even giving us enough sense to recognize. Oh God, we thank you. We thank you on today, God. Oh God, we just want to thank you, Father God, for the many, many, many things that you have done for us. Lord, we want to thank you for pulling us out of that place, Father God, of bondage, God. We want to thank you for pulling us out of that place, Father God, of leaning to our own understanding, God. We want to thank you for pulling us out of that place of pride and unforgiveness. We want to thank you in advance, God.
I've been used by so many other things, but
we want to thank you in advance, God, for the plan that you have for our life, Father God, because you have a good plan for us, God. We may not understand the plan, God. We may not even know the plan, Father God, but we know whatever plan it is, God. It's an expected end. Oh God, we want to thank you on today, God. And we want to thank you for moving some things out the way, Father God, in the name of Jesus. And even in the midst of you moving some things out the way, God, we have a tendency of trying to go back and pull it back in. We have a tendency of just keep running to that thing, God. We want to thank you for your constant mercy. Even in spite of us being our own selves doing our own thing. Oh God, we want to thank you, God, for that mercy. Because you knew, God, that we wasn't going to do right. You knew, God, we was going to be stiff-necked. You knew it. But God, we come to you on today in appreciation and for thanks for your forgiveness and for your mercies, God. Because God, no matter what, I just want to please you, God. We just want to please you, God. And even in spite of us, Father God, in the name of Jesus, doing what we want and acting the way we want and performing. The acts that we want, I rebuke that spirit of fornication right now in the name of Jesus. I rebuke that spirit of self-will right now in the name of Jesus. Oh God, I'm coming to you today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, asking you for your help. Asking you to help not just me, but your people, Father God, in the name of Jesus. I'm asking you right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus, that you would cleanse and wash us, make us whole, because I know that you are a God of a second and a third and a fourth and a hundred chances. Lord, I'm asking you right now, Father God, to stimulate our minds and our hearts, Father God, in the name of Jesus. That we won't be so hard-hearted. That we won't be so stiff-necked on today, God. That we won't walk in so much pride. of us just too prideful to even say that we're sorry, even if the Lord tells you to. You won't even say it. Because 90% of the time you think you ain't even did nothing wrong. And even if you did, it was so hard to just simply apologize. Oh God, I'm asking you to help us on today, God. I'm asking you, God, to move some things out the way, Father God. Because we keep stumbling, we keep tripping, we keep going backwards, God. Lord, we desire to please you, Father God. And you're so merciful, you keep forgiving us, God. You keep forgiving us, God. And for that, Lord, we want to say thank you, God. For that, it's a song ringing in my heart. That I have to play. Because some of us, we really believe that all is well. We really believe that things are just hunky-dory. So, I'm gonna play this song while y'all continue to praise and thank him, worship him, and tell him how much you love him. But the question is, do you know why you're praising him? Do you know why you're thanking him? Do you know why you worship him? Do you know why you love him? So I'm gonna cry out for you today. Lord, I'm asking you to help us. I'm asking you to help us on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, because Lord, we want to get it right. Not only do we want to get it right, Lord, we need you to help us from our own selves, God. We allow our own selves to go into shipwreck. A lot of things that we do, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we really don't want to do. We really don't want to act a certain kind of way, Father God. But it's so many fears that try to overtake us, Father God, until we keep running back. We keep running to the side. We keep running. We just don't know how to just simply be still and know that you are God. So I'm crying out to you on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, on behalf of your people as well as myself, Father God. Oh God, we need you to touch each and every situation on today, God. We need you to touch each and every heart on today, God. We need you to touch each and every mind on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask you to open up our hearts and our minds, God, that we may be able to recognize, Father God, that there is only one thing that causes us to be so messed up. And that's unforgiveness. We don't want to forgive. Lord, we need you on today. Father God. We need you in the most unusual way, Father God, in the name of Jesus, because it's some acts that's been performed against your people, God. It's some acts that's been performed against us individually, Father God. It's some things, Father God, that's even been performed against us, even in our childhood, God, that we took into our adolescent years, God. We brought it into our adulthood, God, and we still have not been able to loose ourselves from these things, Father God, and we are in bondage on today, Father God, because we really don't know how to do a thing because we wasn't taught a thing, God. We really don't know how to do a thing, Father God, in the name of Jesus, because we have not even performed the thing, Father God, because we don't even know to perform that thing, Father God. And even the very things that we have even learned, God, we still ain't doing it appropriately, God. Heart that meets your standards. So I'm asking you to help us on today, Father God. I'm asking you to help us on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, because we entrap our own selves, God. We bewitch our own selves, God. I'm asking you, Lord, to remove that know-it-all spirit on today, God. I'm asking you on today, Father God, in the name of Jesus, to break up the fallow ground within our hearts. Give us a heart of flesh on today, God. Because God, it's some things that we have buried. It's some things that we have swept under the rug within our hearts, God, and we believe that we've been delivered. We believe that we've been healed, God. We even believe that we have been set free, but in actuality, Father God, it's all messed up. I'm asking you to help us on today, God. Because, God, we don't want to be left behind. I don't want to be left behind. So God, I'm going to ask you to help us on today, God. Because whatever you're doing in this season, I don't want you to do it without me, God. I don't. So, the Lord has been showing me some things and sharing some things with me. And I want to share it with you guys. I want to share it with you guys. I want to first, because y'all already asked God to do some things for you. Last Sunday, he had me to ask everybody to write down everything that they fear, no matter what it is, big or small, and put it on the altar. That's what he had me to have everybody to do last Sunday. So it was some people that wasn't here. Jermonica, give them some paper and pen. Everybody that wasn't here last Sunday, please raise your hand. I'm going to have her give y'all some paper and pen so you can write down anything that you fear, big or small, it does not matter, and I want you to put it on the altar. If there's anybody in here that was here last Sunday that want to write down some more stuff that you fear, that you recognize you was afraid of, then get it. Because God is doing something this week. He had me to ask you guys, don't leave Sister Thelma before seeing me. I got something for you. Listen. No matter what is going on in our lives, we really just want to please God. And whatever he's doing, we don't want him to do it without us. I don't. This song been ringing in my spirit all night and half of the day. Anybody that was not here last Sunday, we're giving y'all some paper so that you can write down all your fears and put it on the altar. Because whatever he doing, we don't want to be missing out. Nicole, I know you got something for me today. So, we want to write down this stuff. All this stuff that you fear, I don't care if it's big or small. It could be a spider. It could be you scared to be homeless. You could, I don't care what it is. It could be something. Whatever you fear, please write it down and put it on this altar. Because this week, all last week, the Lord told me to tell people from Wednesday to Wednesday that the only thing that you're going to ask him for, you're not going to ask him for anything. The only thing that you're going to do when you go to him, you're going to praise him, you're going to thank him, you're going to worship him, and you're going to love him. That's all you're going to do. And he gave me the right that while y'all just praising, thanking, worshiping, and loving on him, he gave me the right and authority to go to him on y'all behalf. Y'all cannot even imagine. He know each and every last one of y'all name by name. He know each and every last one of y'all and everything that's going on. And so he had me, I'm literally telling you, individually put you in my face and he told me what to pray for. Every little, and even the attachments to you, he had me praying for. I've been doing that all week. So you ain't got to tell him what you need or what you want or what you desire, because he already knows. He already knows. But whatever it was, we do not want God to do it without us. We don't want him to do it without us. I don't. So it's a lot of times that we just got to ask God to help us from messing up our own selves. Help me, God. Deliver me from me. I'm going to tell y'all ladies what we're doing. Last Sunday, the Lord had us to write down everything that we fear. It don't matter what it is. We want to write it on a yellow sheet of paper with red pen. Any and everything that we fear. It could be a spider. It could be loneliness. It could be love. It don't matter what it is. Write it down, and I want y'all to put it on the altar. The only thing that y'all supposed to do until Wednesday night is praise, thank him, worship, and love him. Y'all don't supposed to do anything else. That's it. Because he doing something in this season. I know he's doing something in this season. And he's exposing these things this season. And so, we put some things on the altar last weekend. And like I said, I've been praying. And in the midst, I've been praying for my own self. Finally praying for my own self. And in the midst, The one thing that I'm most afraid of is not pleasing God. And that's just me. I ain't talking about nobody else, please. So I ain't trying to make nobody feel no type of way. It's not pleasing God. And so when you go and you get to telling God, Lord, I just want to please you, God. I just want to do what you want me to do and how you want me to do it. And let me tell you something. God gonna get to showing you yourself. He gonna get to showing you, because your desire is just to simply please God. And in you not pleasing him, he gonna let you know what you're doing wrong or how you're doing it wrong. I'm just gonna play that one more time. He gonna let you know what you're doing and how you're doing it. He's gonna literally open that thing up to you so that you can know. So in the midst of me praying, I'm saying this while y'all writing. Gwen, you wasn't here last Sunday, so the Lord is, give her some paper for me, please, Jermonica. The Lord is allowing us to write down all our fears on a piece of paper, baby. And she's going to give you some yellow paper and pen. And then y'all can, when y'all finish writing it down, it could be 100 things. It don't matter. Y'all can come put it up here on the altar. But I just want to share some things with you guys. In the midst of me waiting for y'all to do that, because I got a word for y'all today. The Lord told me that one of the biggest things that is so hard for us to do as human beings, one of the biggest things, listen to me, everybody think it's fornication and having sex out of wedlock, don't they? It's not. It's unforgiveness. We simply don't want to forgive. We say it with our mouths. We even think it. We even believe that we have forgiveness within our heart. We believe that. I want y'all to keep that on y'all mind while y'all write. Because whatever he's doing in this season, I don't want him to do it without me. And I know he's doing something great. And I know he's doing something wonderful. I know he is. So when he starts showing you, don't turn a deaf ear. Don't turn your head the other way. Because it ain't always the other folk's fault. It ain't always that person or that thing or that situation by half chance. It could very well be both of the people for it. It could very, but when he starts showing you, please, don't turn a deaf ear. Because we all have sinned and fallen short. Include me. And that's why I always sit up here and I tell y'all this. I'm not exempt either. And I always tell all my business. Because I don't want nobody to ever think or ever believe that leaders got it all together, because they don't. We human and we natural too. While y'all looking at the fault of the pastor be looking at the fault of y'all and the evangelist. But that's how we do one another. Hey, ain't that how we do one another? And that ain't even how it's supposed to be. Unforgiveness. Why it's so hard for us to forgive? Because we stiff-necked. Because we hard-hearted. And when you keep on getting hurt or keep on experiencing something or keep on going through a certain other thing, I'm here to admit it. It's hard to forgive. Is it hard to forgive? It's hard to forgive. It's even right now, we still holding on to some unforgiveness in our hearts from even our very childhood. Yeah. Some things that's been said. Some things that's been done. Some acts that's been performed. Some situations that should not have even happened. Some stuff. They keep on just clawing and digging and nagging at us. Yeah. We say we forgave. Do y'all know what forgiveness does? I mean, I'm really trying to not get ahead of myself. But do y'all really know what forgiveness does? Forgiveness is rewards. It's some kind of love thing. I'm really trying not to get ahead of myself. While y'all writing, I'm really trying to hold on. Listen to me when I tell you. We need some deliverance. We need God to help us to not destroy our own selves.
He restoreth my soul.
That's what we need.
When you become a believer,
we need God to help us not to destroy our own selves.
Sometimes the soul doesn't get the notice.
I see y'all writing. When y'all get going, just come put it up here. I ain't rushing nobody, because sometimes it takes time to write down all the mess that we're afraid of.
God wants to heal.
To write down all that stuff.
Some people's actions are not because their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole.
Y'all hear that, sir?
May this wisdom
It's something.
And remind you that God wants to heal the hope in your soul.
It's something.
I have my sister Leandria here. She's going to help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
We need God to help us be delivered from our own selves. Jeremiah chapter 17. That's where we're going to start at.
Because all I seem to do
Jesus.
Is hurt me.
We can't even get our own selves together. Because we be so busy trying to get everybody else together. Looking at everybody else for. And don't want to forgive folk from stuff. And then let me tell you something. Don't be in a position where you got some kind of authority ship, or you got some kind of hold, or you'll stay your hand from a very person that you can help because you still ain't forgave them, or you don't like them for some odd reason. That's what we do. We need deliverance from our own selves. We do. We do. So how do we hurt our own selves? How do we simply hurt our own selves? 90% of the time, we don't even know we hurt our own selves. I done told y'all, and I want y'all to remember this, because I'm going to give y'all a story. What just happened to me. What just happened to me. Listen to me when I tell you. We hurt our own selves. We hurt our own selves. How do we hurt our own selves? We don't even have a clue. You could think you're doing something right and yet doing something wrong. Not even knowing. Not even knowing. Sometimes we get to going through some things and experiencing some things until we don't even know that we hurting our own selves. Sometimes we be so doggone clouded with thinking that we doing something right until God can put good right in your face and you cannot even see it. The Bible says so. Jeremiah 17. Let's go to the book. Because I don't want y'all to think that I'm just making up stuff. Or I'm just saying stuff. I don't want y'all to think that. Because I ain't pointing no fingers and wagging no heads today. We simply going to talk about Yvette as an example. How about that? Me. How about that? That's what we're going to do today. If y'all ain't got no Bibles, there's some under the seat, some of them. Jeremiah. Chapter 17. If y'all need to take notes, because this is real good to me. We stuck. We in bondage. We in bondage. And we believe we okay. When God gets to showing you, you baby, it's okay to accept it. Because that's the only way you gonna step forward and begin to be delivered. And when you begin to get delivered, baby, and you get to that place of freedom, are you gonna feel like a totally different individual? Believe that. Believe that. I'm going to give y'all a story, a true story. Did I say I was talking about Yvette today? We're going to talk about Yvette. I'm always talking about myself, ain't I? It's okay. So, when I was really young and I used to pray, I used to always ask God to remove certain stuff from me. First thing, jealousy, enviousness, backbiting, tailbearing, covetousness, lavishness, maliciousness, debate, hate, fornication, masturbation, pride. I used to ask him to remove all that stuff from me. Because I did not want to be bound, and I ain't want to do his people any kind of way. I wanted to sincerely be able to pray for somebody fervently. I wanted my heart to be pure when I came to you and said, I love you, even if you was a stranger. I wanted that thing to be right. I wanted it to. And so as years went by, the Lord started transforming some things inside of me. And fashioning me to be what he wanted me to be. And in doing so, I had to experience some things and overcome some things and go through some things and cry out some things. Had to. It's all part of it. And so, in me experiencing these things, I continually pray, Lord, help me to love people no matter what they say, how they treat me, and such and such. And so when I start getting to that point, I knew it because in the very individual that would come up against me or say something to me or hurt me or do something to me, I would feel sorry for them and just start praying for them because I felt like they really don't know what they're doing. And that's a spirit anyway. I'm going to pray that God deliver them from that. I'm going to pray that. Especially because of where he placed me as a prophet. First prophet, then pastor. I had to go to people and tell them things. And it wasn't all good all the time. It'll make them feel some type of way. It was rebukes and reproofs and love. And you know, he had me to do these things. And so I had to continue to pray and ask God that I won't get in a place where I'm pointing my finger or wagging my head at nobody. I don't want to fall in that place of being self-righteous, because if I talk and judge and say, I may turn around and do the exact same thing that I'm talking to you about. So yeah, I had my struggles. I had my things and still, so I just kept going to God. Lord, help me. When I couldn't stop smoking weed, and I couldn't stop smoking cigarettes, when I couldn't stop fornicating, when I couldn't stop, I kept going to God repetitively. Repetitively. And he constantly kept forgiving me. Constantly. And even though I didn't have no intentions of doing that thing over and over again, it kept on coming before me. It was always there. I couldn't shake it. I couldn't walk away from it. Oh, baby, how hard it was. I couldn't stop it. I could not find myself in that place where I needed to be, that was required of me. No matter how hard I tried, I just couldn't get it right. So I kept praying, kept fasting, and kept pressing. I ain't stopped. I didn't give up because of my fault, because the Lord told me that he's married to a backslider. I was. He told me. So I know I won't get no divorce decree because he don't believe in it anyway. He just did it all because of the hardness of our heart. Ah, yeah, there it is. The hardness of our heart. See? He told me that he would give me a brand new mercy every single day of my life because he know I wasn't going to get it right. Not only do I not know how to forgive another, I cannot even simply forgive my own self. Jeremiah 17. We're going to start at verse 5. And we're going to read 5 through 10. And listen to me, I just sat up here and told y'all that sometimes we believe that we doing everything right and we got everything together. And listen to me when I sit up here and tell you, you can think and believe a certain thing, but it's some stuff that's required of you, and there are some consequences. And God can put the very thing in your face. In your face. You hear what I say? That is good, and you won't see it. He'll put the very thing in your heart, and you will not take heed to it. We're going to start at Jeremiah 17, chapter 5. Listen to what the Lord said. Read.
Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man, and maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departed from the Lord.
See, it's a lot of times that we get to dealing with people, and we get to dealing with folk, and it turns our heart. It can turn your heart to good. It can turn your heart to bad. It can turn your heart to worse. It can turn your heart to the worstest. Follow me. Keep reading.
For he shall be like the heat in the desert, and shall not see when good cometh.
It can clearly blind you. Okay, let me make this clear. This thing could have been happened to you years and years ago. And years that went by, and you in a whole totally different place in God. And because of the very thing that turned your heart, the very person that turned your heart, then, now, can blind you from that very thing that God is trying to show you. Are y'all following me? Read.
But shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land.
Again, you wonder why everything is a chaos and a mess in your life. Read.
Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river.
We all believe that we're in a certain place in God because we trust in him, don't we? This is to get real good. I'm including myself, y'all know that. Because we're talking about Yvette today. We ain't talking about nobody else. But if you put that shoe on and it's too little and you say, ouch, it's for you too. Read the book.
And shall not see when he cometh, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit.
Those are the perks that you get for trusting in God. But see, he gave you the two scenarios. What'll happen when you don't trust him, and what'll happen when you do. And the scenario only comes to one conclusion. Read the book.
The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?
You think you know everything about yourself, don't you? You think you know your heart. You think you know you're okay. You think you forgave. You think you done turned the other cheek. That's what you think. But this is what God does. Read 10.
I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doing.
Stop right there. Now, I want you to go to Luke. I want you to keep that in mind, what we just read. I want you to keep that in mind, what we just read. Because the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked above all things. Who can know? You don't know what's in your own heart. You don't know what's in your own heart. You don't know everything. You don't. You cannot justify your actions. You cannot justify what you do. You cannot sit up here and reason with your justifications. Because we take our justifications and we try to reason. Oh, why? And this is why I do this. And this is why I act like this. And this is what I have done. And this is what I won't do. And we all the time got to justify when I'm telling you all y'all hearts are deceitful, including mine. and is wicked. You saved ancient. Sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues. Okay, Lord, I just want to please you. Okay, God, I just want to do this. I just want to. Okay. We're moving right along, right? Let's go to Luke. Let's do Luke chapter 7. And we're going to start at 36. See, because sometimes you ain't even simply got to open up your mouth and ask nobody to forgive you. You don't. And even if you go to a person and ask them to forgive you, you may be saying it with your mouth or thinking it in your head, but in actuality, in your heart, you don't forgive that person. Or they say, oh, I forgive you. Oh, I forgave them already. Oh, I forgive. Yeah, oh, okay. Yeah. Especially when stuff constantly keep happening to you. You sabotage your own self. That's what we do. That's what we do. Because we think that we done forgave. We think that we done moved on. We think that we have simply forgot. But in the midst of us thinking, why is it so easy to start comparing? Why is it so easy for us to fall in that place? Because it brings back flashbacks. You get to having flashbacks, baby. So, boop, smack you right upside your head. You got to shake it off. you get to remembering some stuff. Now, let me say it like I hear it. You get to remembering some stuff. Not remembering, remembering, because it keeps bumping you upside your head. So, sometimes we got to simply just forget. Even from my past. Because some of these things have a tendency of causing us to become hard-hearted. Not even knowing it. I ain't even got to my story yet. So, chapter 7. We're going to start at verse 36. And I want you to read all the way to verse 50. And I want y'all to listen to this, because I'm going to be explaining some things on the way, because I want y'all to really get this thing today. And then we're going to go back to another scripture in Galatians. Because until we get to this place that we need to be in totally forgiving, we won't be free. We're in bondage. And I'm telling y'all, everybody in here in bondage. Everybody. Now, you can get big man, little man. I'm telling you. Everybody is in bondage right now. Because in some form or fashion, you ain't forgave something or somebody. And then guess what? If you say you did, I know you didn't, because he's showing me right now. And it's sitting in your heart. It's sitting in your heart. It's here. So we're going to help each other today. We're going to go to Luke 7. Start at 36. This is Jesus, y'all. Yet again, mingling with all sorts of folk and people and their foolishness. Like he do with us today. With all our foolishness. Okay. Read.
And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him.
And we always want God to sup with us. Come on in the room, God. Oh, God, be with us, Lord. Oh, God, I want to just sit at the table and sup with you. We always want to invite him in. That's what we always want to do. Because, so you know, the Pharisee that asked God to come, he was in authority. This was a man in authority. And you know what he said about the Pharisees? You know, they pride, think they all that. I got it together. I pray all the time. I fast. You know how we do. That's self-righteous stuff. That's who invited Jesus to their house. Come on, I want you to come. So I got the man with the plan in my house. But even in actuality, he ain't even. You know what? I'm getting ahead of myself. Come on. speak.
And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment.
Stop. So, it specifically said that Jesus went into the house of a Pharisee and sat and eat with them. But there was this one particular woman that wanted to come upon him because she wanted something from God. Let me tell you something. Everybody that approached Jesus, they wanted something. Even the ones that mocked him, higher than the local sheep, they wanted something from Jesus. They did. They wanted to ask him some questions. They wanted to try him. They wanted to see whether or not he was just who he said he was. So this lady here, you know, she had to want something from him because she approached him. Everybody that approached him wanted something, whether it was good or whether it was bad. So she heard that he was here. Now, in order for her to even want to approach him, even in her ear hearing, she knew it was something that he could do for her. Because she didn't just come to him, but she came to him bearing gifts. Also, when I say bearing gifts, do you think I'm talking about money? When I say coming to God bearing gifts, I'm talking about praise, worship. But that's something else. Read the book. The Bible says that she had an alabaster box. Read.
And stood at his feet behind him weeping and began to wash his feet with tears.
The Bible says that she was behind him. The Bible already says that he was sitting down, right? So she was behind him crying. The Bible says that she was crying. See, sometimes you ain't even gotta open up your mouth when you go into him. The Bible clarified and simply says she was a woman and she was a sinner. So we know exactly who she is. And we know her acts because it's specified. Now, the Bible says she was behind him crying. Look, this lady, not only did she go to Jesus for something, she did not even feel worthy enough to stand before him. Are y'all getting this? I want y'all to get it. Because we come to God any kind of way. We come to him any kind of way. Bow. The Bible says that she was behind him. What did it say? Tears. Read.
And did wipe them with the hairs of her head.
Start that scripture over, please.
And stood at his feet behind him weeping and began to wash his feet with tears.
Look.
And did wipe
Stop.
Her head.
Listen to me when I sit up here and tell you. Not only did she come up behind him, so she behind him, and the Bible says that she started crying and her tears fell on his feet. So what was she? She was where? Down. How many times I told y'all you gotta go down before you come up? Ah, my God. I'm trying to get through this. I'm trying to get through this. Because it's so good to me. The Bible says that she came up behind him. And in the midst of coming up behind him, the Bible says that she was crying tears. And the tears hit his feet. And she didn't have a cloth, y'all. The Bible says she took her hair. So, who gonna cry on my feet and wipe my feet with their hair? Because my feet dirty, ain't they? You know, back then, they didn't really have no shoes. They had on sandals and just a little thing, like a little thong going through. So, you know, their feet was real dirty because guess what? It wasn't no pavement. They didn't have the luxuries that we have today. Read the book.
And kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment.
Not only did she cry and wiped his feet with her hair, the Bible says that she kissed his feet and then wiped his feet with ointment. Y'all don't even know the symbolic meaning of that, but I'm going to help you in 1 minute. But we're going to get back to that because we got to keep moving. I want to tell y'all something. Read.
Now when the Pharisee which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself,
look,
saying,
don't we all the time look at what I say about comparing? Huh? We all the time looking at somebody else and thinking in our mind and in our heart towards somebody, especially if they acting in some way. Was she not performing an act? Was she not coming in there doing something that's totally out of the ordinary? So if you is involved with an individual or talking to an individual, it ain't got to be nothing intimate. It could just be a friendship. It could just be a supervisor, a person lower than you relationship. It could be any kind of relationship. We always try to compare. Don't be on a job and your boss or your supervisor looking at you. They gonna compare you with the other worker over there. Oh, they doing this and they ain't doing that. Or they doing, oh, don't mess around and your mama and your daddy comparing you with your siblings. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I went through that too. We talking about it yesterday. How about being in a relationship and this person comparing you to this person or that person or what you do or how you act or whatever. We all the time want to compare somebody to, and how about we compare ourselves to other individuals? How many times you say, oh, I wish I was like that. We all the time, it's a natural thing. I'm just telling the truth. Who big mad or little mad, I don't care. Not today. Because I'm going to tell y'all what he did for me. I'm going to tell y'all how I got my freedom. But we're going to get to that. Keep reading.
This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who.
Now, don't mess around and be a leader. Oh, you ain't see that? Oh, you ain't know that? Oh, you couldn't discern that? You didn't. So, now everybody got to know it all, spirit, right? Okay, I prayed for that too this morning. Then I read the book.
This man, if he were a prophet,
now mind you, all the time he's talking and thinking. Don't you know everything that you think, everything that you conjure in your heart, even the very things that you don't even know is in your heart. Don't you know God searches the hearts and the reins and the minds and all that stuff of the people? He already knows what's in the inside of you. Even though you may not even know, how about you don't even want to admit you a mess? How we don't want to admit we're a mess. I never ever deny anything concerning me. Never. Because I ain't got time to be lying. I ain't got time to be faking it till I make it. No, I want to make it for real. I want to make it for real. And my biggest fear is to not please God. And I was doing some things that wasn't pleasing to him. And I'm going to tell y'all today. Read.
Who and what manner of woman this is that touches him?
For don't she you know who sinner. She is? She a sinner and she crying and wiping his feet. What he don't know? He letting her touch him. He don't even know. Now the Lord already know. Yeah. Read. Listen to this.
And Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee.
I got a question for you.
And he said,
I'm gonna ask you something. Oh, I always do that too. I do. Anybody in here know me? I'd be like, you know, I want to, let me ask you something. Because he been already told me some things. But I want to ask you something. I want to see if you're going to admit some things. I want to see if you can see you. So let me ask you something. Let me see where you at. Let me see where you at. Because we all want to be on the same place and on the same level as God, right? We ain't got that kind of power to be on the same level as stuff. So I just want y'all to not even think about that. Come on, read the book.
There was a certain creditor which had two.
Listen debtors, to this story.
The one owed 500 pence and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me therefore, which of them will love him most?
Stop. It was two creditors. One owed 50 and the other one 100. One owed more than the other. And when they came to collect their money, that person didn't have it. Neither one of them. They didn't get mad, or they didn't get angry, but they forgave them. Who do you think gonna love them the most? The one who owed the most, right? So the one who owed the most has been forgiven the most. Ha! Huh. Y'all ain't getting it. See, what we need to understand is, and I ain't gonna say that shit, I'm gonna say this. We gotta first forgive one another. For the Bible says that if your brother or your sister sin against you 7 times, say, well, how many times you supposed to forgive? 7 times, 7 times. So you supposed to keep forgiving them repetitively. You don't want to keep holding it over their heads. You don't want to hold it in your heart and be like, oh, and then they sin on you again, then you bring it up again. You know, you did this, and you watch it, and you said, we always doing it. And this is the word that I, Yvette, say all the time. You all the time doing that. Did I say I'm talking about Yvette today? I'm talking about me. I ain't pointing no fingers, but again, you put on that shoe too little and say, ouch, you know it's you. Big man, little man. I don't care. Listen. Read.
Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most.
The most.
And he said unto him, thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house. Thou gavest me no water.
You gave me nothing. All you wanted was for me to come into your house. So then what? You could talk about, oh, Jesus came to me. Oh, Jesus talks to me. Oh, Jesus always with me. Oh, Jesus. Why? Why did you want me to come there? You ain't even all the, and you know my feet dirty because I've been walking all day. I'm all the time walking around with y'all heathens. I'm all the time doing something for you. Every time you come to me, you're asking me for something. You ain't even washed my feet. Come on.
But she has washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss.
You ain't even kissed me. Don't the Bible say we're supposed to hug and greet each other with a kiss? You ain't even kissed me. What do you think of me? You think that I'm somebody evidently, and you invited me here. So we invite God into our hearts because we think he can do something or he can fix something, and we won't even let him. Simon didn't let him. Simon didn't even consider in doing so. He was just worried about somebody else pointing a finger, looking and comparing and blaming. Ha, that's what he was doing. Read the book.
But this woman, since the time I came in, has not ceased to kiss my
feet. And she, listen. Oh, wait. I ain't going to say that yet. Go on, keep reading.
My head with oil thou didst not anoint.
You did not even pour no oil on my head. You ain't did nothing. And what she do? Read it.
But this woman has anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins which are many.
Her sins are forgiven. And she didn't ask me to forgive her. Huh? She didn't ask me to forgive her. But she came to me with a contrite spirit. She knows she was a woman of low stature. She knows she was a sinner. She knows she could not even compare to him. She knows she could not even stand before him. So she went behind him. And in the midst of looking behind him, you know she did not even look up to him. How can you look up to somebody when your tears is on their feet and you wiping their feet with your hair? You can't look up and do that at the same time. She knows she was not worthy of him. She knows she was not even fit to be in his space. She know, and yet, even in the midst of doing what she was doing, she never once asked Jesus to forgive her for nothing. But because of her hidden motives, baby, because of that thing that was in her heart that was tearing her apart, that thing, ha, that thing, baby, that kept her feeling some type of way. She couldn't even speak. All she could do was cry and go down, baby. A sister went down yesterday. Ha. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Listen to me. There's only one that can forgive you of your sins. And yet, the Bible says that if we don't forgive one another, he's not going to forgive us. But we desire him to forgive us. We desire him to forgive us. Keita, give me some water, please. Listen to this. Here's my story. I'll tell you about God. I'm going to play this song. Because years ago, this song used to minister to me so much. My God, listen to these words. I want y'all to listen to these words before I tell y'all my story. Because my story is going to help y'all. It's going to help y'all. Because I faced some things that I may not just get delivered, but to simply be free. See, I seek after freedom. Not just for me, but for you. I want everybody in here to be free. Give me that, please. Thank you, sweetie. I want everybody to be free. And when your leader cannot use themselves as a true example, you better get up and walk out that door. Because everything in secret, baby, gonna come to the light. And I don't have no secrets. Because there's not nothing that I'm ashamed of anymore. Because God delivered me. He set me free. So let me tell y'all a story. Y'all listen to that. So I explained to y'all what the Lord said for y'all to do all week. And that was for two. First, put our fears on the altar. And then we are supposed to praise, thank him, worship him, and then tell him how much we love him. I know some of y'all wonder why I love God so much. What did the Bible say about the two debtors? One of them only had a few sins. But the other one had a whole bunch. So me, myself, I love on him a whole lot. Because he didn't just forgive me, but he took me out of that place of sin. And when I do go to sin or try, he convicts me and I feel some type of way. So he said, first put our fears up here. We're talking about event. I put my fears up here. My biggest fear is not to please God. My biggest fear is hell. My biggest fear is not hearing his voice, because I've been hearing it for so long. My biggest fear is him not accepting me when I go to his throne. So when I go to his throne, baby, I go to him with everything in me. Because I love him a whole lot. Because I was in debt a whole lot. Listen to me. So, yesterday, we came in here for 12 noon prayer. And they was praising and worshiping. There was quite a few of us in here on yesterday. Thank God for the prayers. They was praising and they was thanking him and they was worshiping him. And I had just got to this end of the wall and was almost through anointing the wall. And all the while I was anointing the wall, the Lord told me to just speak in my heavenly language. I could not speak nothing in English. So I started from this end, and all the while, Jesus. I'm gonna try to get through this. I got to the end almost. And instantly, he took me into a Thanksgiving worship. And in the midst of me giving him thanks and praising him and worshiping him, he instantly took me back into my heavenly language and started showing me individual faces of the prayers that was on the altar. He had not even shown me this yet. I'm going to tell y'all when he showed me this. We talking about the ones on the altar. See, because these are repetitive. These still going to get burned up. So, he started showing me the faces and calling out the prayers individually by name in my face like this. And I went into my heavenly language because he did not allow me to pray for you guys out loud for the enemy to come and snatch. See, he can't understand it. So, as I was praying for you guys, hard, crying, screaming, next thing you know, he had me to start praying for myself. I very rarely pray for myself. Y'all may not believe that. But I don't even be concerned about me. For real, for real. That's why when stuff hit me, it hit me so hard. Because I don't pray for me like that. I pray for God's people. So, I was standing up here and had my back this way. And I was rocking back and forth. And he had me to start praying for myself. And in the midst of him having me to pray for myself, he showed me my heart. I had, listen to me. The Lord has given me a certain type of heart, okay? And in him giving me this type of heart, I have a lot of compassion and piety, and I love everybody, and I'm real temperate. The last year of my life has changed. Listen. The Lord started showing me what happened over the last year of my life. Because the time that Keita been knowing me for almost 4 years, the last year of my life has been different. Before the last year of my life, I was extremely temperate with him. I ain't get mad. It wasn't easy to make me mad. I ain't lash out. And you know some things I experienced. I didn't say certain things about people. And if somebody else did, what I say? Don't do that. Don't. It's just crap. That's what I just, some things changed in my life. And he started showing me how a certain spirit attached itself to my life. And the only way that a spirit can attach itself to your life is through communication. Okay? Because of the communication, that spirit attached itself to me. Why? Anybody know? I'm gonna tell you. Don't answer. It's because it was familiar from my past. from my past before I said yes, Lord, for real. I ain't had no patience. I was extremely not temperate with nobody. Quick temper. Zero tolerance for stuff. And if I saw it, I'm calling it out. And I don't give a rest to tell how you feel. And I'm going to walk away. And I'm walking. Over the last 20 years, God healed me from that. He healed me from that because I was standing before his people. And I can't be wrong. The last year, so many things occurred in my life that very spirit attached itself from me from the communication. The communication is not even aware that this spirit is attached. Why? Because like me and anybody else who is in Christ, they believe, they really believe that I'm okay. And ain't nothing wrong. Until you go to God about your own self. Show me, Lord. Because I don't want to do anything that's not pleasing in your sight. So as I stood here, I say, Lord, show me. Because I don't want to be without you. I don't want to. And he showed me my heart. Guess what he showed me? He showed me first. Who knows that there is life in the blood? If you ain't got no blood in your body naturally, you're going to die. In Christ, it's life in the blood. Listen to me when I tell you. I'm trying to get through this without crying. I cried so much yesterday until I thought my ass was going to be swollen this morning. Listen. The Lord showed me that me, Yvette, I had taken my heart and detached it from my organs and my body. That no blood flow can make it to my heart. And in the midst of me taking my heart, I put it inside of a cement, and my whole heart was covered in cement. Me, Yvette. Then he showed me the reason why I did it. What I said about the justification for the reason. He said, I said, Lord, I did that because, and I was giving him all these reasons. What did the Bible say? What we read in Jeremiah about that change? He said, be quiet. And simply just listen to me. Then he showed me my heart again. Now I'm a person who stand before you guys. Me. I'm a person that can labor and pray for you and God will make everything happen. Me. Either. One of the ones that when I go to God, he give me results, not just on my behalf, but on your behalf, me. And he showed me my heart. He showed me that I took my heart and detached it. And I tried to justify and reason with him why I did it. I did. I'll be all by myself. And so in the midst of me justifying, because don't nobody pray for Yvette if I don't simply say pray for me. Nobody. If I don't say pray for me. You just ain't gonna be able to look at Yvette and tell something wrong. You ain't gonna be able to look at Yvette and know that it's something going on with me. Because I just don't expose stuff like that concerning me. And so in the midst of him showing me this, and I was trying to justify, he sent Bridget up to the altar. And she put a cross on my heart. She being obedient. She don't even know what's going on in the spirit realm with me and God. She don't. She took her hand and put it on my heart. Her other hand on my back. And she just started speaking in tongues. When she came, I was still speaking in tongues, and I was just talking to God. And he was showing me. And as I was justifying, he told me to be quiet and shut up and just simply listen. And then this is what he told me. Because my biggest fear is not to please God. He said, you have not just hardened your heart, but you have been rebellious towards me. And you have been disobedient. He said, you come to me and you ask me on your behalf to sever things. He said, you have come to me and you have asked me to take this thing so heavy up off your heart. He said, you have come to me and asked me to wipe the mere thought from your mind. And then you tell me to help you to forgive. And you don't even recognize that you have taken your heart and put it in a place where can't nobody touch it. Not even me. Because of what has happened. Even what I have showed you, and you know, and still could not get a person and just simply tell the truth. Even in the midst of it, you say that you forgave with your mouth and in your mind, but in your heart, you have not forgiven. He said, you are rebellious against what I fashioned. And you are disobedient. You say you want my will to be done, but you ask me to simply sever what I willed. He said, you are not pleasing in my sight. They're about to kill me. That took me to a place where I thought I had simply passed over 2 years. I never would have imagined that me, Yvette, would allow her heart to get in a place where it should not be. And I cry, and I cry, and I cry. And then I repent, because it grieves me so much. And I was literally standing, and she was with me on the altar. I saw both of us in the front of God like this. And she was pleading my case for me and my heart. And then I felt a change taking place inside of me. I literally saw all that cement just start crumbling and fall into the ground yesterday. In the midst of me repenting, because God ordained the thing, and I asked him to sever it because of my emotional hurt and pain, my expectations. I asked him to take a thing so heavy up off my heart and erase it simply from my mind. And so in the midst of I'm seeing all that crumbling, it did not crumble until I said, okay, God. Ah! It did not stop hurting. Ah! Until I said, okay, God, whatever your will is, God, I won't be mean to him no more, God. I won't act a certain way no more. I will not stop what you are doing anymore, God. I will walk away from your will, God. I endure. I won't be so hard. I, God, I promise. I promise I'll forgive for everything, even in the state of everything. And I believe it's unforgivable. I'll do it. I'll do it. I won't do what I want to do no more concerning that situation. I won't pray what I want to pray no more concerning that thing, God, because I know. I just want to be pleasing in your sight. And then, that's when I saw that brick just crumble. I saw it just crumble. Because the one thing I never want to be, and that's not pleasing in the sight of God. I don't care what another individual is doing. I don't care how they act. You got to deal with God. So let me tell you something, brother. You don't see that forgiveness thing. When you start forgiving a person for that much, baby, that love gonna overtake you. You hear what I'm saying? For the Bible says that love covers a multitude of sins. We take that scripture for granted because we really to forgive us for the multitude of sins, the sacrifice he had to go through. What is your own sacrifice? I'm not sacrificing my salvation. All because a person say a thing or do a thing or ain't lining up or ain't act. You do you. Because I'm going to do me. And long as I stand in line with God, you might not be making it with me, baby. But it's a guarantee I'm pressing to get in. And I ain't going to let nobody hold me back. Not from the mere thing of being hurt. From the mere thing of feeling some type of way. When you know. When you simply know the truth. Listen to me. Forgive today. Forgive today. Because until I say, yes, Lord, I won't do this no more and I won't do that no more, God, and I surrender all for real, your will be done, God, not mine. See, because I want to walk in his will. I'm not responsible for who ain't going to walk in his will. You understand? I'm responsible for your soul, baby, but I can't make you lie, no, God. And if I change you don't, my hands is clean. Listen to me today. I'm not going to be bound to unforgiveness. And yesterday, after the Lord healed me, I can't stop smiling after that. And I don't feel heavy. It don't even matter to me no more. I don't even care. It is so good. I just want to be pleasing in God's sight. I don't care what nobody think about me. I don't care what they say about me. I don't care if they compare me or point their finger at or pull out my faults. I don't give a rat's tail. You just better get yourself together with God. Because we got to seek out our own soul salvation. And if nothing else, I know my worth in God. And if don't nobody else love me, I know he do. I had justified so much until I simply say, Lord. I say, God, you sitting up here and you telling me this and you telling me that. And they don't even deserve my love. Now what you put inside of me, they don't even deserve it. And I want to take it back. I don't want to. The Lord told me, he said, who are you? He do deserve it. I made him worthy. And it can only come from you. So me and my actions has hindered that person from simply being free. I cried even the more. Because me, I'm hindering somebody from simply getting free. All from me giving what the Lord wants. And that's love. That has never been experienced before. Y'all just don't know how that made me feel. Because we may think and believe that a person don't deserve a thing all because of the way we feel emotionally. But deep down inside, that ain't how we feel. Those are our emotions talking. And then he say, now simply admit it. So I stand here today telling all my business again because he told me to. I'm not ashamed. I'm messed up. Okay, buddy? And so you know, when you get a leader who cannot tell that they are men, why do you think we join together? Why do you think we join together? It's not about me. It's all about him. And he wants each and every last one of us to simply just be free. Who have you not forgiven? Even from your past. Who have you not? Because guess what? It's not for you to be feeling some type of way that I'm forgiven. No, it's for your freedom. I dare you to forgive today. I know how I feel. I'm crying because I hurt that man. I hurt God. Do y'all hear what I say? My biggest fear is not to please him. Who have you not forgiven? Who have done something to you so much and so bad until you compare? That means you ain't forgave. That means you have not forgiven. Who have done something to you so bad until even if you say you forgive, you always bringing it back up? You ain't forgave. You ain't forgave. So, before I call you guys to the altar, I want everybody to shake their hands. Give everybody a yellow sheet of paper. Everybody that you think did something to you, you got to lose that thing today. You got to seek for your freedom today. You have to. You have to. I don't care who it is. A landlord. Oh yeah, they've been picking on me. My neighbors, they've been picking on me. Folk been picking on me. Yeah, folk been really doing me some type of way. I don't care if it's a friend on your job, a foe. I don't give a rat's tail if it's somebody from your past, an old love, an ex, a husband, a wife. I don't give a rat's tail who it is. Because everybody got somebody that they have not forgiven. And guess what? It's more than one person. It's more than one person. We all need help in forgiving. Because I actually prayed for myself. And I feel like I used to feel years ago. I feel real good. I feel real good. And I want everybody else to feel good too. Because I'm grateful that God even forgave me. And because of my gratitude, I'm going to have enough sense to forgive that ex-wife who did me some type of way. To forgive that ex-husband who acted some type of way. To forgive that boyfriend and that girlfriend. To forgive my sister and my brother. To forgive my mother and my father. I'm going to have enough sense to forgive my uncle who molested me. I'm going to have enough sense to forgive my sister who slandered me. My mama who rejected me. I'm going to have enough sense to simply just forgive. Because I'm not going to be bound. I'm going to forgive that abuser. That man who abused me verbally, emotionally. I'm going to forgive him. Yeah. I'm going to forgive that person who used me for my money. Yeah. And for my good works. I'm going to forgive that person for being cruel to me when I was only nice. We sabotage our own selves. We sabotage our own selves, says God. Yes. We sabotage one thing because we want another thing. Jesus. Oh God, help us to forgive. Because we are grateful, God, that you even forgave us, Father God. Sometimes it be hard for us to forgive. I want y'all to go all the way down to y'all childhood and start forgiving. I want y'all to forgive y'all father. fathers for doing certain things to your mother. I want you to forgive your mother for walking out on your daddy. Ha! I want you to simply forgive each and every little bitty thing. I want you to rest, tell what it is. I want y'all to forgive that borrower that never paid back. Forgive them. Don't even look for nothing back. I want y'all to forgive that person who stole your shoes and even tried to steal your very joy. I want you to forgive them. Oh God, touch your people, God. Cover them in your blood and hide them behind your cross, Father God. Give them your peace, God. Even in they forgiving, Father God, let them forgive the very act that the person even performed, because even in you forgiving that person, you got to forgive the act that they performed for your freedom, for your deliverance, for your wholeness, oh God, for your completeness, for your completeness. Yeah. You got to do it. You got to do it. Because you're going to see the, you're going to see the kingdom of God. The Bible says, for brother, you have been called unto liberty. Only use liberty for an occasion to the flesh. But by love, serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this. That one word is love. And the only way that you can forgive is if you got some type of love in your heart. And if you ain't got that love in your heart, you are no son or no daughter of God. Because the Bible says that God is love. Are y'all following me? Huh? The Bible goes on to say, there's only one word, even in this. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Do you love me like you love yourself? Because if you love me like you love yourself, you ain't going to be talking about me. If you love me like you love yourself, you're not going to compare me with nobody else. If you love me like you say you love me, you're going to simply forgive me. And you ain't going to try to pick out my faults. If you love me like you say you love me, you ain't going to be talking about me to nobody else. You ain't going to be doing all these different other things. See, because why you doing these things, you need to know that you're not going to see the kingdom of God. You need to know that you are in air. And I wouldn't give a rat's tail who you is. Because I never got it all together. Oh, even in your anger, if you don't forgive me for the very thing that I did for you, you hellbound, baby. Just know it. The Bible says so. It goes on to say, but if ye bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one another. Why you trying to see my demise? Why you always talking bad about me? Oh, in a good way? Yeah, right. Oh, okay. You mean ill against me. Just like I do you when I say something about you to another individual. Just like when I call a bitch to somebody. Yeah, I'm biting on you just like you biting on me. And if you bite hard enough, don't you know I'm going to bleed? I don't want to bleed out. Because if I ain't got no blood in my body, then I ain't going to have no life. I want my life. I want my life. That's what I want. I want my life. This I say then, walk in the spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. If you're in the spirit, baby, that spirit going to check you when you get to thinking a certain type of way about somebody. That spirit going to check you when you want to say something ill about somebody. Huh? That spirit going to check you when you act in a certain way about somebody and you find yourself constantly saying, oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so tired of saying I'm sorry. I just got to keep saying it. I say I'm sorry so much and say, well, why you keep saying you're sorry? Because I am. And I mean that. Listen to me. The Bible goes on to say, for the flesh lusts against the spirit. So even when you want to do what the spirit say, your flesh don't make you do something else. You can very well want to line up with God. You can very well want his will to be done. But your flesh and the things that you see gonna make you go this way when God say go that way. You're gonna want that thing when God say take another thing. You're gonna wanna do this thing when God say do this thing. It's the war and the fight. I just said, I don't care how much you get saved. Your flesh don't never get saved. It don't. The Bible says we are not to fall lusts to it. That's what the Bible says. He says that in these are contrary one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. You want to do right. But because that flesh got you looking at another thing, got you comparing another thing, got you looking for fun in another thing, got you acting a certain kind of way, got you talking a certain type of way, got you thinking a certain type of way, until you can't do what you need. And it's simply to be obedient. But if you be led of the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication. Y'all know fornication is having sex out of wedlock. Uncleanliness, lavishness is something that is perverted, whether it is spoken, taught, thought, or even written. Huh? We talking about idolatry. You could very well get something, you could love it so much. Guess what? You're raising it above God, and it's a form of idolatry. It could be a job, it could be a hospital, it could be anything. It could be a very human being. Witchcraft is control. That's simply to just try to control. Hatred. Variance is to disagree. We all the time disagree. The Bible says, how and why can we just not reason together? We can't reason together. No. We can't reason together because we got so much going on inside of us. We got so many things that's going on inside of us. Emulations. That's against anything that's spoken from this book that is not from this book. Anything that's contrary to the word of God. That's what emulations mean. And wrath and strife. Ha. Ha. My goodness. Seditions is to coerce. Seditions is to try to convince. I'm trying to convince you not to do this with this person at that church. Don't go to this. I'm trying to. And what about heresies? Y'all know what heresies is, don't y'all? Y'all know heresies is against anything. Emulations is being competitive. Huh, reveling in such of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. So why you going to try to provoke somebody to act a certain type of way? Why you going to provoke somebody to do a certain type of thing? What's really going on with us? Huh? We sabotage our own selves, says God. He said, not me. So if you big mad or little mad, guess what? You big mad or little mad ain't him. Because if nothing else, I want to be obedient to God. And I'm going to say exactly what he said. If you put your foot in that shoe and it hurt and it's too little, out, Chuck, take it. Do what you will with it. It's totally and strictly up to you. We must forgive. And in forgiving, we got to have some type of love down inside of our hearts. Don't just say, I forgive with the words that come out of your mouth. And you thinking that you forgave. That's why he had me to read Jeremiah 17. Did you hear what I said? The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked above all things. Who can know? You don't even know what's in your own heart. And because you don't know what's in your own heart, the very thing that God gives to you, you are blinded to it. Because you're doing whatever you want to do, however you want to do it, where you want. I know because I'm talking about it. I ain't talking about nobody else. I'm talking about me. And it's rebellion. And it's disobedience. Because let me tell you something about God. He said obedience is better than a sacrifice. So I don't care how much you pray for people. I don't care how much you come on an altar and do whatever you're going to do in the church. If you're not obedient to God, guess what? It's rebellion. And you will not see the kingdom of God. He said it, not me. And again, I'm talking about it. Because I don't want to can't get it right. I want to get that thing right, baby, because I'm scared of hell. Read the book of Revelations, it'll describe to you what goes on down there. I don't want to know. I'm scared to be doing all these works. And he cracked that sky right now. And he said, depart from me. I know you not. You worker of iniquity. I want to be in that place. We're talking about events. Everybody in here got an opportunity to seek out their own soul salvation. Everybody, as you come to the altar, please put this stuff on the altar. I'm going to pray for you guys.